looking at mandatory minimum sentences in Pennsylvania. I'm Jill Horner. This is Comcast Newsmakers. With me is Pennsylvania State Representative Pam DeLissio. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
This has been recently in the news in Pennsylvania. It's an issue that the legislature is addressing now. But talk to us a little bit about where this stands right now. There have been a variety of pieces of legislation related to it. But you have concerns related to mandatory minimum sentences. And you say they don't necessarily work. Why do you think that's the case?
Well, there are sentencing commissions that establish sentencing guidelines. That's within the confines of the judiciary. Lately, there have been quite a few instances where the legislature, Senate and or House, have been introducing and passing legislation requiring minimum mandatory sentences. So that takes away from the judge any opportunity to allow for any type of extenuating circumstance related to a case because that minimum has been set by law.
Now, when we talk about particular crimes, are there certain crimes, though, where there should be mandatory minimums put in place for the most heinous of crimes?
Well, I think those are set by that sentencing commission, and that's where it should be appropriately set, not by the legislature. And those guidelines are in place. There's mechanisms to review those and to constantly evaluate that. I think when the legislature gets involved in that, it's a different situation, and I don't think it's our role to do that.
Talk to us about what's happening right now as it relates to the legislature and the legislative process when it comes to these mandatory minimums, because there have been a variety of pieces of legislation related to this, including one related to welfare fraud. There's a piece of legislation related to that, for example.
Well, mandatory minimums don't necessarily in and of themselves deter crime. You're not going to have a criminal say, oh my goodness, the House, you know, the legislature just passed a new law where this is no longer a misdemeanor, it's now a felony. You know, I'm not going to commit that crime. That's not how it works. So number one, it's not a deterrent. Number two, there is an inherent cost involved, and that cost is material. It costs approximately $33,000 to $34,000 a year to house an incarcerated individual. So, for instance, if somebody commits welfare fraud, and I believe it was in the range of $1,000 to $2,000 worth of welfare fraud, there was a piece of legislation that mandated a minimum sentence. And I believe that minimum sentence was either 1 or 2 years. So for $1,000 or $2,000 of fraud, and I'm not advocating fraud, we're going to spend as taxpayers $34,000 a year in order to penalize that. I think taxpayers as well as society would be better served if community service were an option or where and if feasible restitution of those dollars.
So when we talk about potential alternatives though, I mean you mentioned community service, potential restitution though, are there additional ways to deter crime other than mandatory minimums? Because obviously we want to crack down on things like fraud or other types of abuse or criminality. Are there other ways to prevent or stop this type of behavior?
Well, I think I like to look at root causes. And when you look at the root cause of that, it's normally folks who are undereducated and feel that they have or actually do have very limited opportunities in this world to better themselves. So we need to constantly be making sure that folks have the best education that we can offer and that those opportunities are pretty much ubiquitous across the board for all of our citizens because folks will make other choices.
And we just have a short time left, but what about judicial discretion? Do you think that should be part of this equation as well?
I think the judge has got the facts before him or her, and they're the best person to evaluate the situation that's before them. If they are being boxed in by a minimum, that's the law, and they have to take it from there.
Thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
We've been talking with Pennsylvania State Representative Pam DeLissio. I'm Jill Horner.